Allegations once again.
We have all heard this. Last week, wasn't there? Last week, the audio. The pipelines were bombed just to remove me. A serving minister can go and bomb the pipelines in the Niger Delta. Somebody that has been a governor, he has been a senator and a minister. He went to bomb the pipeline. Nobody makes any payment in NDDC without God's will, Akpabio's approval. When we first came to NDDC, on the day of going for the inauguration, he told me in the car that, Madam MD, if you don't do what I say, the same pen with which I used to sign your letter, it will be the same pen that I will use to remove you. He said the first thing I should do when I get to Port Harcourt is to change the dollars in the NDDC account.
The NDDC controversy. We have still with us in the studio Liboris Oshoma, legal practitioner. Thank you very much for your time.
My pleasure, Liz.
We started this conversation earlier. These allegations, very weighty, it seems, a minister bombing, allegedly, a pipeline, something he should be protecting. Is this something that should be paid attention to by the presidency, or is this just the angry rant of a woman, as alluded to by the minister?
Even if it's an angry rant of a woman, like they say, hair has no fury like a woman's scorn. So I think it is not something we sweep under the carpet, considering also her position in the NDDC. She also would be aware of internal happenings in the Niger Delta. And also, coupled with the fact that a lot of politicians had at some point be accused of, conniving or being hand in glove with some of these militants that they used to win elections. So it wouldn't be out of place for these allegations to be thoroughly investigated. But typical of this government, being a serving minister, I think they'll probably look the other way until it becomes so overwhelming and that they can no longer avoid it. And then at that time, we'll see all the rush and all of the, news highlights, trying to do what they ought to have done, long before now. In the same vein, all of these issues of NDDC wouldn't have come up if the president had been up and doing. If the president had sat down and said, you know what? Yes, I want to correct all the anomalies. I am inaugurating a board, but I need to audit this, NDDC from inception or from where you want to, conduct a forensic audit. All you need are your internal auditors, and they go in and then look at all the books. But a situation where it is, crystal clear, it is on record that the NDDC, politicians have consistently used, the NDDC to develop their pockets rather than developing the region. And mind you, these are people from this same region who, even Akpabio alluded to the fact that, NDDC had always been to rehabilitate politicians who want to go into election. And so against that backdrop, one would have expected that a serious-minded government that is truly, ready and intended to fight corruption would not, be setting up an interim management committee, of people who also are now fighting themselves.
Let's look at another allegation. And I'm bringing this up because the executive director of projects of Niger Delta of the NDDC said he did not take an oath of any form. But the MD, in her accusation, said she was being compelled to take an oath of some sort in order to help her carry out her assignment. Are you aware that oath taking after an appointment is part of the NDDC protocol?
No, it is not. But this is not the first time all of these are coming to the fore in Nigerian politics and public life. If you remember also, the former governor of Abia State, Theodore Oji, there were allegations that he was made to take an oath by the then governor, Oji Zokalu, before he would you know, be supported to be governor. And they were also aware that there are so many people, you know, who go to godfathers, you know, seeking for appointment, and godfathers will compel them, you know, to take oaths, you know, of allegiance to them, and in some cases, you know, occultic oaths. And so it's not out of place. These are still in the realm of allegation. What I expected is these two, they let, what I actually, you know, expected is not, and a minister who is interested, is an interested party, say governor, was a former governor, you know, in that region, is an interested party, can never conduct, you know, an independent audit of the organization. Mind you, his former deputy, Nkere Sima, was, you know, the outgone MD of the NDDC. And then, against all of this backdrop, what you would expect, let this, if you want to truly look into it, let the president have independent body, go talk to some of these staffs or even some of the members appointed independently. Not, you know,
again,
with what we are saying. By the time you talk to them independently, you will truly get to the root of all of this.
I want to address another part of what the executive director of Project NDDC said in a last night in an interview on a television station. He said that there might be. He said there might be a misunderstanding of the processes when he was questioned about monies that was deposited in his account for students, international students that are studying abroad on the scholarship of the NDDC. Could this all then, all this misunderstanding, be a misunderstanding of processes of how things are being done? Could that be a possible defense?
You look, it's either the money is in your account or it's not in your account. There is no misunderstanding about it. Monies that are meant for scholarship programs, there are processes for sending those money to those schools. The moment those monies are in a private account of a member of the board or a staff of the NDDC, it means that those money were not meant for what, you know, they were earmarked for. And then secondly, it means that the actual amount that was supposedly claimed to be the amount for those scholarship is not what it is. Because if you're sending $20,000 to, let's say, University of Dundee in Scotland, do you need to first send the money to Felicity's account? Or you just send it to University of Dundee for so-and-so student with so-and-so matriculation number? So it is not a misconception, it's not a misunderstanding, it is sheer fraud. And right. So we should call it by its name.
While we await the presidency's reaction to all of this, we thank you for your time.
My pleasure.